slides up.
Okay.
You can just use share screen at the bottom, and I think it should show us your
Okay. Slide. Should I put them now?
Yeah, why don't you throw it up there now? And let's just double check, make sure.
Okay. Yeah, okay, but wait.
There we go. Yep, we can see the PowerPoint. So if you want to put it in slide mode.
Yeah, okay.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Sure.
All right, folks, welcome to the Wiesenthal lecture for today. I'm very happy that we have Dr. Daniela White currently with Entegris. She has a good longstanding history of innovation and basically product development, design, and scientific understanding in industry. Most appropriately, or most importantly, with Dr. Kelleher and I, when we worked together more than 10 years ago now at Cabot Microelectronics over in Aurora. Dr. White worked for me and my group. We hired her to be our polymer expert, but she's proved herself to be an expert in chemistry, flat out, period, right? She knows her stuff really well. And I think the thing you're going to find interesting about her talk is how we stress so much in our teaching of you all, the fundamentals. She totally embodies that and uses it for very practical problem solving and really detailed problem solving. Having that strong fundamental background is really important. I would think she's gonna emphasize that, and it's been a big major part of her career. She's a very generous human being. She actually included Dr. Kelleher and I in one of her patent inventions while at Cabot.
Was well deserved.
she had many since that time. She got her PhD, her bachelor's and PhD are in chemical engineering. She was educated in Romania, where she's from originally. And she went to, basically, it's the MIT of Romania. And her postdoctoral work here in the United States, Rensselaer Polytech, and with Chris Matyshevsky, right?
Carnegie Mellon, yeah.
At Carnegie Mellon, who's an expert in polymer synthesis and characterization. And as I said, mm-hmm. It's a lot of time in industry. So I'm gonna turn it over to her. Please hold your questions to the end. We'll leave some time open for that. But use the virtual hand clap, and please help me in welcoming Dr. Daniela White.
Okay, thank you, John. You have to help me here with technology. How can I minimize? Okay, I'll minimize your faces. I'm sorry, as much as I wanted to see your faces, no, the whole time, but my cover some of my important, aspect of my slides. So, so thank you, John, again, and it's a pleasure to see you and Jason again. Didn't see you in a while. what are we going to talk today? And some of the subjects, I'm going to go briefly through them just because of lack of time, not because the subjects are not interesting, the topics are not interesting. So I'm going to present Entegris really at a glance, and then the link between semiconductors and biotechnology. This is just a personal opinion, so don't take me too seriously about that. You'll see. And then two projects I work personally, I was involved in, and I thought I solved some problems related to theranostic nanoparticles, more specifically gold nanoparticles with peptides as affinity ligands for a surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy applications in nanomedicine. So this is a part of my work. I've done at Memorial Sloan Kettering, like early 2013, I think. Yeah. And then benefits of nanoencapsulation of poorly water-soluble phytochemicals or nutraceuticals. This is part of the work I've done when I worked at Pepsi R&D. I had fun there. It was interesting. They don't have scientists there. That's why I left. But, it was interesting experience there. And a few conclusions. this is the dry part of the talk. So Entegris was founded in 1966, has more than 5,000 employees, headquarters are in Billerica, Massachusetts. In terms of revenue, it's growing every year. Like you see this year, I think we have really a record year in terms of revenue and stock options too. And then the R&D commitment is around 10% of the revenue for 2021. And I think it's the same every year. Integris has lots of scientists and engineers, very creative, with over 3,000 patents. And it's a market leader in contamination control and critical materials handling, advanced process materials, and semiconductor post-EMP cleaning and etching. This is the division I work in. And just briefly, the industries included in the Integris interests are semiconductor, life sciences, and other high-tech industries. Didn't have enough room, but you can check the website to see. My business unit is specialty chemicals and engineered materials, and many groups. And actually, interesting work is done in all these groups, focused on specialty gases, post-etch and post-CMP cleaning formulations, plating and CMP components, CMP slurries. We acquired. I mean, it's all in the open. You guys probably know John and Jason Sinmat from Professor Singh from Florida. So we acquired his company. So we are involved right now in CMP, making CMP slurries, but just for specific applications like silicon carbide, gallium nitride, carbon films, advanced deposition materials, graphite and silicon carbide and specialty coatings. Then microcontamination control, you know, filters and purifiers, gas filters, diffusers, purifiers, airborne control, contamination control. And then advanced materials handling, microenvironments, fluid handling, sensing and control, liquid packaging. I thought I should advertise this, you know, for everybody. So it's a very diverse company, in other words. I'm going to share our post-CMP development team and the locations. It's a global team. We have the biggest group is in Danbury Technical Center, Danbury, Connecticut. And then part of our analytical group is in Burnett, Texas. So we work very close together. We have also a technical center in Taiwan, PhD engineers, pilot technicians, CMP, CMP center, clean room, Mirai, Ibarra. It's just the latest technology. And we have also Korea Technical Center, where we have a PhD scientist, one tech, but a lot of analytical capabilities there. Speaking of analytical capabilities, I'm not going to read for you. It's too much reading and I'm going to lose my voice. But as you see here, we have pretty much everything in terms of instrumentation we need for our work and more. And what we don't have in our location, we can access through our analytical PhD scientists. Like for instance, we have an XPS specialist that goes to Yale University to run XPS samples for us, and then Tof Sims. Another person goes to Columbia in New York to run for us. So we have pretty much everything. And when you realize we don't have something, we buy it. There are challenges, and these are the kind of the most recent ones. And you guys, you know, as we go from like nodes, shrinking of the nodes from 10 nanometers right now to 2-3 in 2022, and who knows what else in the future. We have to work with the more exotic metals, and you know that these more exotic metals are not very friendly because they are very inert, and hard to activate them, hard to clean them. So it was easy, let's say, talking about copper tantalum. There were some challenges in terms of, so we are talking about cleaning wafers post-CMP. So the CMP is doing the mess, and then we have to fix it. So it's not always easy, because CMP has usually very good scientists, and they know what they are doing, and they use, you know, ligands and surfactants and whatever in their slurries. They know they can stay forever. They are very useful, but they can stay forever on the surface of the wafer. So then we have to be very creative and clean them. So that's why I'm talking about organic residues, silica defects, low K defectivity, corrosion, ring scratches. Moving towards cobalt liner, we have additional challenges in terms of copper cobalt galvanic corrosion, also cobalt recess in the precipitates, cobalt complexes precipitates. Now moving towards ruthenium liner replacing cobalt, we have additional challenges in terms of cleaning ruthenium metal or ruthenium dioxide residues from CMP, and also on the wafers and on the pad, we need to have very low static etch rates. You remember from when we worked together, harsh chemistry is needed to polish it and also to clean it. So it's pretty challenging. And then moving further in the future, we have more exotic metals like molybdenum replacing tungsten and platinum group and binary compounds to all sorts of weird combinations. But as you see here, we've been successful with PORs at major fabs and also current projects and future projects, but we started to work with them too. Dielectric. So other projects I'm involved in directly are the ones concerning 3D NAND. It's a lot to talk about that, and I don't want to, you know, but 3D NAND structures right now for increasing the capacity of flash memory chips. So just in a few words, so 2D NAND structures are the ones like flat horizontal structures. In order to increase the capacity, these structures should be extended, so should become bigger, larger. But it's all about shrinking. So people came from semiconductor industry came with the ingenious idea to stack them. Instead of expanding horizontally, they expanded vertically. Now they can go right now up to almost 200 multi-stack layers, and based on silicon nitride and silicon oxide alternating layers, and you see in this picture. And this is one project. The silicon nitride has to be etched, and silicon oxide has to stay. And the challenges are the very high silicon nitride etch rates, higher than 50 nanometers per minute. Then no removal of silicon oxide at all, so etch rate zero. It's not very simple. No silicic acid redeposition precipitation on the silicon oxide surfaces, and wetting ability as you go and work in taller multi-stacks, it's very hard to wet inside, so vertically, unless you use surfactants and then surfactants stick to the surface of silicon oxide and again, troubles. But, you know, it's not just working with customers. We had recently some fun doing some mechanistic studies on phosphoric acid, on silicon nitride actually being etched by phosphoric acid. And I don't know if you know, you might wonder, but this is a very old technique, like 50, 60 years old. And still in literature, there wasn't a very clear mechanism explaining the uniqueness actually of the phosphoric acid as etchant. Why just phosphoric acid? Why not other acids, you know, protic acids like hydrochloric or nitric or methane sulfonic, or just why phosphoric? So I've been wondering about this like for a while, and finally we ran some mechanistic experiments last summer, and recently we published a paper, and John knows because I talked to him a little bit in between experiments about this. But what's interesting is this, what we reported and what we think the main difference between phosphoric acid proton transfer in phosphoric acid concentrated solutions and the other acids concentrated solutions. So we found some differences that would explain the high reactivity in silicon nitride etching. This is the proton transport vehicle mechanism for everything. So normal, known, you know, by everybody in electrolytes. So this is the diffusion controlled mechanism where the proton goes, interacts with the water molecule, forms the hydronium or oxonium cations, and they just, you know, go here and there, just being controlled by diffusion. And so something like that. But what we discovered in the case of phosphoric acid mechanism is the transfer is different. The proton actually hops between different molecules of phosphoric acid. So something like that. right? So the proton goes from one molecule to another and to another and to another. So, and the, or something like, oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, let's see, doesn't work. It's okay. But anyway, so what we suggested is, you know, since phosphoric acid aggregates as dimers and then as triple ions, we have conductivity measurements. And if you find this paper, it's free on ResearchGate and it's open access. So these triple ions actually are specifically sized the same way as to fit perfectly on the surface of silicon nitride. So we calculated the bond lengths and everything. So the proton transported between phosphoric acid molecules, it's easier to hop on the surface of silicon nitride, protonate it, and then we have hydrolysis and so on. So we thought it was interesting and we got excited about this. Anyway, that's it about Integris, and just wanted to say that we are doing interesting work, and I couldn't present more work and more mechanistic, you know, understanding studies done there, because you understand about the, you know, secrecy agreement and not just with Dr. Parker and Dr. Kelleher, but with all of us, we had to sign something like that. So would have been a little bit difficult, maybe in the future. Well, just a few thoughts I had based on these cartoons I found in literature a while ago, right? Just, it's just really food for thought. It's nothing like claiming anything, like we know everything about those. But I see chips, right? They are mainly semiconductor thin layers with gates, right? With gates and channels for electron transport. And look at this scheme too. Just look at the picture. Then what do computer chips and cells? So moving from computer chips and the world semiconductor world to the world of biology, cells have in common. Anyway, so they all have in common frontier interest, intersecting sciences, right? So they were born at the intersection of some frontier sciences, right? So studies in cell biology, chemistry and biology, in IC, physics, and chemistry, and then biochemistry was born and biophysics was born. So these are the frontier sciences that they have in common, actually. So biochemistry and biophysics are common for the alive world as well as the, let's say, semiconductor world. They don't want to call it dead world, but anyway. So more similarities are about the cell membrane. And this is the cell membrane in a cell. And it's not that simple. It's not just the phospholipid layer and the hydrophobic fatty acid tails. It's what's inside, what goes through this membrane. And if you look here, we have all these GPCRs, which are G protein coupled receptors. You know, they are responsible about these transmembrane receptors. They are responsible about the transport of nutrients and information in the membrane, the cell membrane. In addition, these membranes are electrically charged, right? Negatively charged. And also they have many channels for ion transport, cation transport. And this is just, if you look at the next slide, this is just like here in an IC computer chip. Right, you have the same transport, basically of information, right? Electron transport and information exchange, and it's the same with the cell membrane. I really like these pictures. I found them a while ago on the internet, and this is when I started to think about, wow, that's really interesting. Because so they are both semiconductor membranes with gates and channels designed for transport and information exchange. So we can think, what else can we do with this in mind? Anyway. So from here, we are going to my first topic on theranostic nanoparticles. I don't know how to get rid of this. Okay, you don't see the title. Theranostic nanoparticles, and with emphasis in gold nanoparticles conjugated with peptides, actually for nanomedicine imaging. Just quickly to explain, let me explain what theranostic nanoparticles are. So they are nanoparticles with double purpose, for diagnostic and for therapy. And diagnostic comes from the nature of the metal in these particles. right? For instance, gold, silver, or copper, you have the opportunity to use them for SERS, so surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. But if it's iron or other magnetic nanoparticles, you can do MRI, and also depending on the ligands on the surface, they can be used for tomography, optical imaging, fluorescence, or photoacoustic. So they are all for diagnostic, right? But if you put, for instance, if you load the particle with drugs, you can use them for drug delivery. If you put a targeted ligands, you can use them to go to the organ you had in mind, so they can accumulate on that organ, and then they can be imaged. So this is what I'm going to talk further. Also, the shape matters in the roughness on the surface. Just in a few words, what's this surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy? And I don't want it, if John, if you have anything to say, if I'm wrong or anything, you are the, you know way better than me. So correct me after we are done, text me and correct me. we're done. I'm not the specialist of that, but I worked with this. So in conventional Raman spectroscopy, so these shapes, the dark blue shapes, consider them as organic molecules. And in this technique, they are called reporter molecules. So here's a table with a typical sum of the bipyridines. They are usually amino phenols, but thiols, like thiophenol. So always is desirable to have like SH functionality because it's very compatible, goes and chemisorbs right away on the gold surface. So in conventional Raman spectroscopy, so let's say we have a laser that emits light around 785, I think, nanometers. And sometimes the emission signal from the particles is very weak. But if these particles, we put them on the surface of the gold nanoparticles in this case, we have an enhanced response signal. And this enhancement is both chemical and electromagnetic. So chemical enhancement comes from when these molecules go, for instance, to the metal surface and they change the polarizability. So that means they become kind of charge transfer. So they charge transfer molecules instead of neutral molecules. And this, in addition to the electromagnetic enhancement that comes from, occurs at the surface of the plasmon, surface plasmon. And these particles, they get excited by light, and then the electromagnetic field is amplified at the metal surface. So the combination between the roughness of the particle and the chemical structure of the reporter molecule that becomes polar in the structure gives the enhanced signal. These particles, see an example of gold nanoparticles. So for instance, what do they do if we inject them in the human body? What do they do? Well, if they have the right affinity ligands at the surface, the goal is to go inside of a cell, and not just any cell, but specific cells, they belong to particular tumors with specific receptors. So the goal is for these particles to accumulate inside of a tumor. If the cell is not treated properly with organic ligands or targeted ligands, they get destroyed in the body. Either they undergo this opsonization process, which is like the cell is just covered by proteins and is destroyed. So it disappears and it's then eliminated. So we don't want this. So the key here is the cell to be properly functionalized. So here it's an example of how these gold nanoparticles are used in this SERS. SERS technique is used for this gold nanoparticles functionalized. So, it's not difficult to make gold nanoparticles just to reduce the chloroauric acid, either with citric acid or ascorbic acid. For ascorbic acid, it's more for star, for nanostars. But, once the particles are made, Then we put some Raman reporter molecules at the surface that we talked about. So the aromatic ones with the thiol functionalities, and then we coat the surface because we want to preserve these molecules and not destroy them further during the bioconjugation reactions. So we are careful to attach first functional groups on the surface like carboxylic, azide, amino, biotin, which is complementary to avidin in different cells. And then we do bioconjugation with specific targeting ligands. And these are the most important, and I'm going to talk about those. What these ligands do, they go to the receptors in the cells, in specific cells we have in mind. So for instance, in specific tumors, the integrin receptors are overexpressed, and this is when these cells, these nanoparticles go to the tumors. Just to give you an example, if the particles are properly targeted, so if they have the proper functionalization, they just go rather to the tumor. And I have to apologize for these pictures. They don't make me feel well, and for people who are sensitive, just don't look. I always believe these mice are alive. And so the particles goes to the tumor, and then he is the laser beam, 785 nanometers. And then this is the CERS image showing that there is a tumor there, actually, right? Because they see the enhanced response from the reporters. But if the particles are not functionalized in the right way, they just go to the liver, and there is no difference between the targeted tumor and non-targeted. So it's very, very important for these particles to be functionalized the right way. And here is just an example. Functionalization is not difficult in this case, as long as people use thiol as compounds, but these are the types of functional groups used. So it can be carboxylic acid, and can be amides, and small fragments of peptides and proteins, even DNA, and complementary DNA for growing, even, you know, technique used in PCR, yeah, like gene sequencing. So that's very important. But the most important chemical reaction that was discovered, and probably everybody is thankful that like 20 years ago, this reaction was discovered in order to facilitate room temperature conjugation of ligands to the surface of nanoparticles, is this one called EDC-NHS. So includes using of carbodiimide for the reaction with carboxylic acid. In other words, this is, you can look and you can say, oh, this is just a amidation reaction between a carboxylic acid and a primary amine. But you know that these reactions cannot take place easily at room temperature. And you have also to eliminate, to distill the water during this reaction, which wouldn't be possible without destroying the organic, the attachments, the peptides, the proteins, or other ligands. So this reaction takes place at room temperature via this acyl isourea labile intermediate, which very easily reacts with this maleimide, succinimide. So with this sulfo hydroxyl succinimide. And then once the maleimide I have in the next slide. So once this succinimide group is attached to the particle, this one reacts very easily with amino functionality from the peptide ligand. And here we form the ligand conjugated nanoparticles. I'll show you the reactions I ran, very similar ones. And this is part of my work I was going to just share with you. The peptide we used was a cyclic RGD peptide. It's a targeted affinity ligand for integrin, overexpressed in glioblastoma cells, a rare form of brain cancer. This peptide was conjugated to gold nanoparticles, and the modified nanoparticles was injected into a mouse with a brain tumor induced by genetic modifications. What we did then was first time when a good chemist did these calculations for the medical team I worked with, we calculated actually the number of peptide molecules per gold nanoparticle, which wasn't done until then. People didn't know. People ran these reactions, conjugation reactions, but they didn't know if how much or how many chains were attached and what was the efficiency of the synthesis. And we calculated using three methods, UVVs, LC-MS, and TGA, thermal gravimetric analysis. And then these particles were further accumulated in the tumor and detected by CERS images. So this is the reaction. So the reaction involved this cyclic RGD, which is an arginine glycine aspartic acid peptide, very common, like I said, for target to react with the targeted cells overexpressed in integrin. And the difunctional cross-linker we used was based on succinimide and maleimide. Succinimide reacts very easily with the amino groups. Maleimide reacts very easily with the thiol groups. So this is the way we attached this this peptide to the surface of our Golgi nanoparticles. So the reaction, it's not too complicated, but we need to be precise with the amounts and times. And then once the adduct was made, we reacted in different amounts with different amounts of Golgi nanoparticles. And then from the supernatant, we calculated the number of unbound peptide adducts by UVVs and LC-MS, and then, of course, the corresponding bound amount. And then from the precipitate from this reaction, we calculated, we analyzed by TGA, again, how much organic residue formed by thermal gravimetric analysis for the composition. Just to show you how we had very good correlation between HPLC and UVVs methods, but also correlation with the TGA method. So overall, the number of peptides wasn't very different, calculated using these two different methods. But remember, the number of thiol groups at the surface of Golgi nanoparticles was 35,000. So efficiency of conjugation wasn't great. And we ascribed this of the steric reasons, because the cyclic molecules, the peptides, are pretty big. There wasn't enough room, actually, at the surface of the Golgi nanoparticles. It was too crowded there for too many these peptide chains to be. But anyway, despite all that, we had good, so this is an image from our research. We had good, accumulation of nanoparticles in the brain, and then a strong CERS signal. Okay, so let's move right now to a more enlightening, more, you know, topic rather than cancer therapy. And this is about stable colloidal nanodispersions by encapsulation of poorly water-soluble phytochemicals, bioactives or nutraceuticals. And this is the work I've done at Pepsi R&D. And I had fun. It was really interesting right after I left CMC. Okay, so let's start by admitting that everybody loves GNC, right? Everybody goes there and we are mesmerized by the types of nutraceuticals and supplements and that we think will make us live forever and spend lots of money there. But here's the thing. Most of these nutraceuticals over the counter taken as powders are a waste of money, just because they come in big, you know, particles, powders. Bioavailability is extremely low. They just don't dissolve in the body, and we eliminate them the way we ingested them. And not very many people know about that. So what was our initiative at Pepsi was, hey, let's make them our solution for increased solubility. Was let's turn them, these big powders, chunks, let's turn them into nanoparticles and then check if we increase the bioavailability. So I'm going to talk about one of our successful examples, quercetin. We worked with more. Resveratrol is another one, very successful for us too. Well, what is quercetin? Everybody heard of quercetin. It's a powerful antioxidant, and also it's used for energy by the athletes. In nature, quercetin is found in like apples and oranges and onions, and but it's found in this form. It's called glycosylated form. So it has a molecule of sugar attached. Well, this molecule of sugar gives the solubility in the human body. So the absorption in humans is like between 20 and 50%. When people process it, take it, then people take it out of the apple and oranges and onions, this sugar molecule is lost. So this eglycone quercetin molecule is not soluble. It's very hydrophobic. You can look here, it's like polyphenol structure. So this is the bioavailability. Is extremely, extremely low. So our goal, like I said, was to design water-soluble dispersions. Very quickly, why these molecules are strong antioxidants, and the catechol groups on the B ring, and also the hydroxyl groups on A and then on C, we have this conjugated 3-OH and conjugated oxo ketone group, and the double bond. So this conjugation gives a lot of delocalization of the electron and makes all these stable radicals. So in case this molecule is attacked by reactive oxygen radical species, this one just takes a hydrogen from here or from here, so it's hydrogen abstraction, and leaves these radicals, the catechol radicals, which delocalize on the structure of the aromatic ring. So that's why they are basically dormant. So that's a good thing. This is how the protection in the body is ensured. But what's going on with this quercetin in the stomach in this form? It's destroyed basically. At low pH in the stomach, scientists found all these aromatic acids formed by the composition of quercetin. So basically it's destroyed. These ones have an antioxidant behavior too, but not as strong as quercetin. So our thinking was, well, we want to make them to encapsulate the quercetin and make it solubilize at high pH rather than low pH, and that would be in the intestines, like enteric way of solubilization. Anyway, so our inspiration came from nature, from the wine industry, just knowing that initially the wine, that the way it comes from the grapes, is very hazy because of the tannins, high concentration of tannins. But what people do, people filter this wine using filters based on proline-rich proteins. And these ones are gelatin, collagen, bromelain, but also recently, like filters made out of PVP, polyvinyl pyrrolidone, so synthetic polymers I used to. So I don't think it's a good thing. But only natural filters, they are the right ones. But anyway, so what's going on when this when the wine containing tannins is filtered? The tannins, the polyphenols, like quercetin, they interact very strongly with the polymeric chains of the proteins and form colloidal complexes, protein polyphenols. Another example is, and everybody knows, like if you make tea, like Lipton tea, looks clear. If you add a few drops of milk, looks like a colloidal dispersion. We measured actually the nanoparticles, like 154 nanometers. And all these complexes are formed by hydrogen bonding and hydrophobic interactions, conformational changes in the sheet, in the beta sheet and alpha helixes of the, so the proteins, basically their secondary structure is altered. But you know, these examples from wine industry and from tea industry gave us the idea. And why don't we try to make colloidal dispersions using these proteins, proline-rich proteins, gelatin, bromelain, and beta-lactoglobulin. And thinking that by mixing the protein, low pH protein, when it's mainly positively charged, so pH lower than isoelectric point, with our cross-linker, which is quercetin in this case, we form these colloidal particles, stable colloidal particles. On the other hand, we use different materials also for encapsulation of quercetin in the form of cellulose derivatives like CMC, carboxymethyl cellulose, ethyl cellulose, hydroxypropyl. And these materials, they are all used in pharmaceutical industry. So they are known is a good encapsulation and inert in the body, encapsulation materials. So here there are a few examples. One thing at Pepsi, we didn't have an SEM, so the images are just taken with a microscope, so they are not really, but at least we could measure the particle sizes of our encapsulated quercetin particles. So they are around 200 nanometers. So we use two techniques to isolate them in a dry form, ethanol evaporation and spray dry. And then we made powders which are redispersible and ready to be added to any beverage or snacks. Here they are the also microscope images of colloidal dispersions of quercetin encapsulated in gelatin and bromelain. And also in beta-lactoglobulin. Of course, we use different ratios of nutraceutical to the protein, and then we, depending on the ratio, we get different particle sizes. In this case, if you see, they go the other way. 1-to-1 ratio with gelatin bromelain, we have small particles, but excess of beta-lactoglobulin gave us small particles. So. How did we know that we made the right thing? And here came the characterization part, where we calculated the solubility of these nanoparticles, quercetin encapsulated in proline-rich proteins and cellulose colloidal dispersion. So solubility in neutral pH water and beverages. And solubility increased up to 80,000 times. And we know that because we did this by a very simple technique, UV technique, because quercetin absorbs in UV, has two big peaks because of the different rings, benzoyl and cinnamoyl. So we drew the calibration curve. So this is how we calculated the dissolved amount of quercetin. On the other hand, also we calculated the encapsulation efficiency. So how did we know how much quercetin went into the particle, how much maybe precipitated or so. Also, we used the UVVs method and we calculated the amount was around 90% for gelatin, for instance. So we are pleased with these measurements, with encapsulation measurements. And of course, we wanted to see where the quercetin is going to be released in the body. Is it going to be released at low pH, like in the stomach and destroyed, or it's going to be enterically released at high pH? So we ran some kinetics of a release of quercetin using buffers at pH 3 and 7.2. And of course, at pH 3, the release rate was very, very low, showing that the complex is still between proteins and the quercetin were still strong. So no degradation in the stomach was preserved until pH 7.2 and started to be released, so enterically. So that was good. It's exactly what we wanted and we predicted. So that was a good thing. How do we know, how did we know we made the right thing? So we also, in addition to everything, we ran a clinical study on people. There were 50 people volunteering to drink. This is some kind of Gatorade where we dissolved 1 gram per liter quercetin. This is a lot, actually. This concentration, colloidal dispersion, 280 nanometers. And the results, the blood test showed that, the bioavailability in serum increased 35 times. So this is the colloidal dispersion in our Gatorade beverage. And this is just control, just quercetin powder. So, so there was success. okay, so I'm pretty much done. Just going to say, just give an example, show an example of probably the next biological powered or biology powered computer and computer chips, right? Just the same biological process that happens that keeps us going, ATP going into ADP, but who knows? We'll see, it's just a thought. Okay, so if you have any questions, or I spoke a little bit too fast trying to keep my time, and if you have any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thanks very much for a great talk. as I hope everybody appreciated, the breadth and width of applications that you've gotten involved in, whether they're deeply scientific, like you were doing in your cancer therapy work, or making new drinks for us, right? New healthy drinks for us, or making better chips, or cell phones work better and computers work better. I hope everyone has a great appreciation for that. So are there any questions? I guess I'm going to go first then. Could you explain? I think one of the things I always found interesting in working with you was the lack of, lack of reservation for delving wide and deep into various forms of available literature. So I liked your slide. It was the Scrabble board where you showed all of this intersectionality between the different sciences, right? Those basic core sciences. And what I always saw you do is we would be doing something in semiconductor industry and you never looked at that literature. You went off and went into the biology literature to learn about ruthenium and how it interacts and so on and so forth. Can you describe for our students why you take that approach? I mean, obviously it's successful, but where in your training did you learn to go so broad with your investigation as you probed into the literature?
Well, just blame it for me being restless, you know, and never pleased with, like easy ways to find information. Or I tell you what it happened, and not everybody, it was a special case. Not everybody is subjected to that. When I was in grad school, I was in the situation to choose myself the subject of my PhD thesis, because my advisor was the first 2 years worked here in the United States and I worked in Romania. So I was on my own, basically. So being on my own and, I went the first place I went to the library, and the library in our university, of course, was we had chemistry books and biology books. And so maybe at the beginning, I thought I didn't find enough information in my chemistry books. So I went to other fields and I say, hey, that's, it's not very different. Look, I find similar reactions like in chemistry, they're biological, or physics, or, you know. So then shortly, I noticed that they all correlate. They all together. And there are applications for the same chemical reaction, can be in my lab, but can be in a biology lab, but a physics lab. So I learned this this early, just during in school. But I don't know. And I was happy. I didn't have actually my advisor, you know, being with me every day there. And but I was on my own. And I was very interested in this kind of things. And I don't know, maybe, it's, yeah.
It's an amazing skill set. And I was just curious if you had to pick one skill set that our students should really work on if they want to go out and have a successful career, for example, working chemistry problems in industry, what skill set do you think that would be?
Well, they have to be curious too. You know, so, and they have to be curious and also try to connect information from everything, all their classes, regardless, you know, in every class, I'm sure they learned, everything they learned in every class, I mean, can be connected and can be, to other classes and then put things together. If we are talking about chemistry, organic chemistry, actually it's at the basis of everything. Everything is organic chemistry. A few years ago, I was actually, before I worked in nanomedicine and Pepsi, I started to be a little bit disappointed because my interest shifted at that time to semiconductor industry. And I wasn't too much updated with the organic, the new developments in the organic chemistry and polymer chemistry. And I thought, you know, what is the organic chemistry and polymer chemistry? I used to study in, you know, new things all the time. You know? And guess what? It's organic chemistry and polymer chemistry is very strong, but recently, I mean, the last I don't know, 8 years or shifted, I think, from pure, we called it chemistry, to more like biochemistry and biology related in this field. So if you look at the biggest accomplishments of the biochemists, bio-nanotechnologists, doctors in these mixed teams, research teams, come from these new organic reactions. And they also the chemists helped them and invented them. And so it shifted a little bit, but organic chemistry, it's basically the basis of everything. Polymer chemistry, molecular biology, genetics, DNA sequencing. I worked in that too. Also a lot of organic chemistry involved there too. So linking molecules together, click reactions based on copper, which for a long time weren't used anywhere else. Right now they are used in biochemistry and nanotechnology. And, you know, it's amazing. But that's, I think, speaking of, you know, the chemist, what they should, you know, have in mind, it's organic chemistry. It's the basis of everything.
Danielle, it's Jason. I applaud you for saying organic chemistry, and I hope all my students heard that. But for me, I want to just share two comments. One, for those who heard Dr. Parker's question about literature, my fondest memory of Daniela is her cube back in Cabot. This was before the days of reading papers online. Daniela printed every paper out and never filed them except for places across her desk. So if you needed literature, you didn't need to go to the internet. You could go to Daniela's desk and get literature on things at Cabot, which was awesome. But Danielle, I do want you to comment on one thing, and I think it's important. Can you stress the importance of coming up with a working mechanism to our students? I think the coolest part about what you've done in industry is that you've connected the theoretical to the application and the mechanism to the application. And I think that's really important. And can you comment on how you see that as so valuable?
Well, yeah, sure, Jason. If you don't understand, if somebody doesn't understand how things work, the mechanism, there is no way, let's say, to go further and improve it, right? So this is the first thing. If you want to, you know, and replicate it, or you just have to understand how, and then it's about problem solving too. Like your customers at some point come. So let's say you have a very good CMP slurry or cleaning formulation, or, you know, but then there are some issues somewhere in the field, and the customer comes back and says, you know, I have this unexpected contamination. I couldn't, what's going on? But unless you understand how your particles interact with the surface of the wafer, you know, or how, what kind of organic residue you have at the surface, what kind of, you know, unless you, what kind of complexes you have, what kind of blobs you have at the surface, you cannot clean it, you cannot solve the problem. You just cannot go in the dark and say, oh, let's try dilute HF or, you know, SPM or anything. No, and I tell you what, the customers, they appreciate so much when we, in our meetings with them and interactions with them, we have mechanistic slides, and we explain them to them. Hey, this is how we think we clean, for instance, because we talk about surface of silicon oxide or silicon nitride, or, you know, and this is the type of contamination we think we have from, we know we have because we analyze it from the CMP slurry. So we draw for them and we explain them. And then we come with the experiments. They show, hey, we think we have still surfactant at the surface because look here, contact angle, right? Water contact angle is very high. So the surface is hydrophobic. And then we cleaned it with our cleaner. And look here, the surface water contact angle is 25. So, and we know that good wetting and lower contact angle means good cleaning. And, you know, and we have good collaboration with many, many customers, very like big fabs, big companies, and they really trust us. So it's that's very important to establish this kind of relationship. And they come to us for anything, and even issues they have with different customers, and they come to us, and because they always appreciate our mechanistic studies and cartoons we put in our presentations and explain, because also they have good, not too many chemists, but a bunch of very bright engineers there, and they like to learn chemistry from us, and they always tell us that, oh, I learned this from you and I learned that from you, and they respect us. So that's very important to understand and what's going on first, because unless you understand what's going on, you cannot fix it. And you cannot go ahead to optimize it, you know, improve, come up with a better product, for instance, if you don't know how your product worked in the first place.
Very true. Thanks, Daniela. And everybody that's on the call today, I did put Daniela's most recent paper in the chat. So I hope you guys take a chance to read it. It's an awesome
that was my pet project, Jason. Last summer we had I had a summer intern, very bright student from Yale Chemical Engineering, and he was so we worked by, you know, just like here, by Zoom, by WebEx, by, you know, and I think we had great collaboration, and just you know, yeah, it came out just like that. I thought it was an interesting topic.
It is an interesting topic, so I hope everybody takes a chance to look at it. So I put it in the chat.
Yeah.
Can we take, let's take one more question. Hopefully, maybe one of the students could chime in. You got a question from any of our students? Don't be shy.
Yeah.
Just turn on your mic.
It was a lot of information, John. You know, probably to follow. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's very complicated, but I hope they have an appreciation that strong fundamentals, curiosity, you can solve anything. As long as you do that, you can solve anything. So, all right, nobody wants to chime in. We're going to let you go because you probably have to get back to your job. One of the disadvantages of working in the semiconductor industry is the rest of Asia is just starting to wake up now. So there will be lots more to Daniela's day, Dr. White's day here. So let's all thank her one more time for taking the time here today and presenting. And we hope everyone has a great weekend. Take care.
Thank you so much, John and Jason. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Daniela.
It was very nice to chat with you. Yeah, good to see you too. Have a nice weekend, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.